We can say that the Muslim fundamentalist world already has a nuclear power, and that is Pakistan.
Wow.
We hope that it could get neutralized by India. But again, we have a major world war coming in our hands. And the problem is bigger than Iran and bigger than even Pakistan's nuclear. Because if you take a census, and we have many surveys, we take a census, whether you look at the Pew statistics, whether you look at the Arabia Network statistics, whether you look at any statistics, you see predominantly in the Muslim world, the majority of the Muslim population want to establish an Islamic government, an Islamic hegemony.
Mm.
Because the problem in the West, they think that Islam is merely a religion, like Mormonism, like Jehovah's Witness, like whatever.
Mm-hmm.
That is not so. Islam is a constitution. And that's one thing Americans don't think about. It's a constitution to be implemented to the entire globe. Christians in the West look for a global religion and a global government. Islam fits that definition to a T.
Mm-mm-mm. Well, goodness, let me ask you this. You know, in reading the first few chapters of your book, Why I Left Jihad, now I'll tell you, Waleed, when I looked at this and it showed the kind of songs you were singing, your hatred of Jews, I mean, from a naturalistic point of view, I mean, you look like a guy that was it. I mean, you're a terrorist, you're in Islam, you know, except for the grace of God, I don't think that anyone could imagine how you could possibly get out of that circle of hate that you were in. I mean, so definitely, I mean, you were the real deal when it comes down to being Islamic and being a terrorist, correct?
That is correct. Many doubted my story. Many challenged my story. Many began to question my story. And I began to prove it. You know, as a matter of fact, my family connection is not only from the Arab side. My mother was an American. So I come from an American connection. My mother met my father in Humboldt State College in California. Her grandfather, my American, basically, great-grandfather, was the mayor of Eureka, California. He was an excellent friend with Winston Churchill. Winston Churchill was notoriously against Hitler. My Arab family side, my family's connection stems to my grandfather, who was an excellent friend and associate of Hajj Amin al-Husseini. He was the Supreme Muslim Council, the Grand Mufti of Jerusalem, who collaborated with Adolf Hitler to destroy all the Jews in the Middle East, which is the part that Westerners don't understand.
Mm.
The connection of the Nazis with Islamic fundamentalism, long time ago, before the Holocaust, and were part of the Holocaust, and they were part of building two divisions, out of eight divisions of the Nazi war machine, which were Muslim fundamentalists. This is information that could be available to any American who checks it.
Mm-hmm.
So the Muslim fundamentalism was a system that was way before the time that we think, because we think that terrorism from the Islamic side began maybe, you know, just before 9/11.
Right.
No.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a lot of people in the West, they just take a political view. They do not know the history of Islam.
Yes, and they don't know the history of the rise of Islamic fundamentalism a long time ago, that Islam from its inception was very fundamentalist and was bruised by the West after the dismantlement of the caliphate in 1924. The Ottoman Empire was defeated by the Christian West, and it was bruised, and it wants to revive its power. And this has been going on for ages. With the fall of communism in Russia, there was a power, an empty void, if you will, because the majority of the Middle East was supported by Russia, and communist Russia. So there was a void to build a power peg. That's when the Islamists saw the time is ripe to rise Islam again and to reestablish what was wounded, which is the caliphate.
All right. Well, tell me this. And you know, and I'm sure that you're aware of all of the different myths that we hear from Islam. What would you say to those who say that that Islam is a religion of peace and it was spread nonviolently throughout the world?
Well, first of all, I think the first answer to the question needs to be a biblical answer, because the problem with solving this whole issue of Islamic fundamentalism is looked at from a secular perspective only, and that's a major problem, because the Bible warned us. It said, by peace he will deceive many. In other words, the spirit of Antichrist that is coming upon the world will have a facade of saying we are peaceful, and at the same right, at the same phase, harbors this destructive element to it that wants to conquer the world. So in the Bible also says, when they say peace and safety, sudden destruction will come. So it will come as this peaceful thing. Islam, if Islam is a peaceful religion per se, then how did Islam spread? No historian in the world will deny that Islam spread throughout the Middle East, all the way to Europe. They occupied Spain. Most Americans think that Islam was a religion of the desert and that was it. It went to Spain. It ruled Spain for hundreds of years. It defeated the Byzantine Empire, which is the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire ceased to exist in the West and continued to exist in Byzantium, which was stationed in Turkey. And what bruised the Roman Empire was the Islamic Empire. People forget that part. Mm. And they ruled the entire East. They defeated all the other empires prior. They defeated the Persians. They defeated the Babylonians. They defeated every other empire before, the Egyptian, everything. It gulped up everything that was written in the Bible regarding all the previous empires as well. So Americans need to understand the grandeur of Islam, the giant of Islam. In fact, when you hear a Muslim sermon, and I could show you examples, in which one sermon says, in the middle of England, the speaker was saying, the world came to know that Islam is strong and powerful, Islam will defeat the West, Islam will rise again. So why do they say the word again? That means it's something that existed in the past, wants to re-rule the world as it ruled a long time ago.
Wow. You know, something that that always also we hear, people try to deny, is the fact that if you're an apostate to Islam, that there is the death penalty. I want to talk to you about that when we come back. Can you stay with us a little while?
Yes, sir.
Everyone, we're talking to, we have a great guest, Waleed Chubat, the author of Why I Left Jihad, the author of another book that we've yet to talk about, and then some other questions that I have for him concerning Islam. You're on Bible Talk, and we'll be right back. Pastor Emery Moss back with you here, pastor of Strictly Biblical Bible Teaching Ministries, also the leader of Bible Boot Camp that supports this radio program, and talking to Waleed Chubat, an ex-Islamic terrorist, now a Christian, as you can clearly see, and I would say also a biblical scholar, who's written the book Why I Left Jihad, and also another book he's going to tell us about, but I still have some things that I need to clarify for me and hopefully for you, too, that are listening. Mr. Chubat. Waleed.
Yes, sir.
Concerning apostates. Now, I was in two Islamic debates in Dearborn, Michigan. And in the debates at the Islamic Center, they didn't really deny this too much. I was wondering, though, that I've never really gotten some specifics on how many Muslim countries practiced the apostate part of Sharia. In other words, if, like it says in the Hadith, according to what Muhammad said, that if you reject your Islamic faith, you're to die. How many countries actually, how many Islamic countries do practice that?
Well, not fully practice it. To a certain extent, be quiet over it. Pakistan has blasphemy laws. They do practice it. You know, they kill a convert and apostates and this kind of thing. Saudi Arabia has it, and many other countries have it. But to the extent of saying all of them practice it, that would be an error. However, in all Muslim countries, if an apostate is killed by the family, their judgment is not the same as murder. So it depends on how fast the ushering of all the countries to adopt the entire Sharia Islamic law, because many Middle Eastern countries have been transformed from the past, you know, via the French mandates or the British mandate, that kind of thing. So they still have some secular laws. However, the apostate law in Islam is very clear. The Prophet of Islam, Muhammad, clearly said, whoever leaves the religion of Islam, kill him.
Let there be no doubt, Islam is a part of America. And I believe that America holds within her the truth that regardless of race, religion, or station in life, all of us share common aspirations.